Hello friends, I'm Manoj Goyal, co-founder of the Wall Street School. In the last decade, we have trained over 10,000 students in the field of financial modeling and valuations. With that experience, we are usually aware of some of the topics what students are most curious about. And calculation of free cash flows to the firm is one of them. That's why we have prepared this video for everyone, in which we will cover what exactly free cash flow means, how cash flows are different from free cash flows, what are different classifications of cash flows, and how they are calculated using a real case study of Hindustan Unilever. In this video, we will cover everything in a step-by-step manner from scratch. So make sure you watch this video till end. So let's get started.
Hello everyone, let us start. So in this video, we are going to learn what do you mean by free cash flows, how free cash flow and cash flows are different, how do you calculate free cash flow, what are the various classifications of cash flows, and then we'll be calculating free cash flows for any Indian company. So let us start. Firstly, let us talk about what do you mean by free cash flows. So free cash flows basically means the cash that is available freely after whatever investments, repayments were required, everything is done, whatever is left with the business, whatever is left with equity shareholders, they can do whatever they want to do with that cash. That is known as free cash flow. That it is free from all the expenses, all the repayments, right? Now cash flows, free cash flows could be divided into two categories. Cash flows that are available freely to the entire firm. By firm here, I mean to the entire business, to the debt holders, equity holders, preference shareholders, everyone. This is known as free cash flow to firm. And another category is called as free cash flow to equity. That is cash available with the owners of the business. That is cash available after making investments in the business, after repaying debt, after repaying interest, whatever is available is belonging to owners. Right, owners can use it the way they want. They can withdraw it, they can withdraw it in the form of dividends, they can reinvest it, they can burn it, it's up to them. This is free cash flow to equity, right? So let us understand this. Cash flows available after investing in the business, whatever the profits were there, out of that, how many are cash profits? From those cash profits available for the business, you need to make investments in working capital. You need to make investments in fixed capital. That is your machinery, land, projects, acquisition, etc. And whatever is left with the entire business and it can do whatever it wants. This is free cash flow to firm. But after making essential investments in the business, in working capital, in fixed capital, debt holders are also to be paid because they want their interest, their principal payment back. So what equity shareholders do? Firstly, they invest in their business. After making investments in the business to sustain business in upcoming years, they repay the debt holders. They pay their interest and principal. And whatever is left after investing in business and after repaying debt holders is the cash that is available freely to the owners of the business. That is known as free cash flow to equity. So till now, we have learned two types of free cash flows, cash flow to the firm, cash flow to the equity. Cash flow to the firm means after making investment in the business, whatever is left is the cash flow to the firm. But after making investments and after repaying debt, whatever is left to equity shareholders, this is free cash flow to equity. Okay, now the question arises why this free cash flow matrix is very important. So as discussed in previous videos, value of any asset is the present value of cash flows that it is generating. By cash flows in that definition means the free cash flows that it is generating. That's why to value any particular company, particular asset, you should know its free cash flows. Now maybe let's try to learn to calculate free cash flows from the desired set of data. Let's learn to calculate it for Indian companies. So for that I'll go to screener.in. So let me search screener. So this is screener.in. Let's search it for maybe Hindustan Unilever. Okay, so this is Hindustan Unilever's screeners feed. If I scroll down, you will see their quarterly results here. I don't need this. You will see their profit and loss account. You will see their balance sheet and you will see their cash flow statement and ratios. So for calculation of free cash flows, I need profit and loss account. I need cash flow statement. That's it, right? So I'll just get this data. So I'll just copy this from here till here. I'll just copy it. We'll go back to my Excel and without any formatting, I'll just paste it. Okay. Then I'll go to cash flow statement. I'll just expand operating activities. I'll expand investing activities. This small plus sign here, I'll expand it. I'll expand financing activities and I'll copy this data. So I'll copy from cash flows all the way till here. Here, I'll copy it and I'll paste it. Okay, so you'll see I have data all the way from March 2009 till March 2020, their profits and their cash flows. I don't need this, so I'll delete it and let us format it so that it becomes legibly better. So Alt H O I to format width. I'll just delete these and we'll write here simply P&L account. I'll delete this part also. Okay, this is the data that I need. Now let's create a new sheet and let's call it as free cash flows. Okay. For that, let us try to create formulas for free cash flows. Okay. So firstly, let me ask you, is net profit profit enjoyed by equity holders or profit enjoyed by the entire firm? That is debt holders, equity holders, preference holders, everyone. Net profit is a profit enjoyed by equity holders. So I cannot consider this to start my FCFF calculation. So which profit is enjoyed by the entire firm? Gross profits, earning before interest, tax and depreciation and amortization, that is EBITDA, or EBIT. Okay, which one is enjoyed by the firm? EBITDA is enjoyed by the entire firm. Okay, so I'll start with EBITDA. If I say less depreciation and amortization, okay, this will become EBIT. So this is cash profits enjoyed by the firm, EBIT. Okay, from this EBIT, that is earning before interest and taxes, firm as a whole will have to pay some taxes, right? Without getting tax benefit of paying debt holders. That is, if you pay interest to someone, if your expenses increases, your tax goes down. But now you are considering, I'm not going to pay anyone anything. So this is my entire profits. On these profits, I have to pay the taxes. So I say less taxes. This is not original taxes paid. This is if there was no debt taken by the firm, no interest paid by the firm, how much taxes they would have paid. Okay, this will give me net operating profit after tax. This is also called as NOPAT. This is operating profit after tax for the entire firm. Okay, from this operating profits, I need to make investments in my working capital. I need to make investments in my fixed assets. So less investment in fixed assets. Okay, then less or add investment in working capital. Why I have written the word add here? Because many times working capital could give you excess cash. That is, suppose if you purchase goods from someone on credit, you will save on cash. If you are saving on cash, this will add up to your cash balances. So if liabilities increases, your cash balance increases. Think about it like this. If you take a loan, your cash increases, right? So if liabilities increases, your cash increases. And if its assets increases, your cash decreases. Suppose you purchase raw material. If you have purchased it in cash, your raw material will increase, your cash will go down. So that's why add and less, both the things for working capital. Okay. Then from these profits, you have paid for your fixed capital, you have paid for your working capital. Still, this net operating profit consists of depreciation and amortization that is deducted, that should not have been deducted ideally. So I say add depreciation and amortization. So then why you deducted it here if you wanted to add it here? The reason is from the amount that is deducted, like from EBITDA, if I deduct depreciation and amortization, I will arrive at my EBIT. Since depreciation and amortization are eligible for your tax benefits, therefore you have to pay profits on EBIT, not EBITDA, that is EBITDA. So you have to deduct it here, and since it is a non-cash expense, you will add it back here. This is just to save your taxes, right? And in reality, depreciation is not taking away any cash from you. This is just to save your taxes. EBITDA minus depreciation will give you EBIT. You pay taxes on it, and since it was a non-cash expense, you are going to add it back. This becomes your formula for FCFF, that is your free cash flow to firm, right? Now let me format it properly. Okay, this is FCFF calculation. So let's start calculating this. Let's get our EBITDA here or EBIT here. We can start with any of the figure we get from their profit and loss account. So see here, I don't need sales expenses, so I'll just delete it. I don't need operating profit margins, I'll delete it. I don't need net profits, EPS, dividend, I'll just delete it. Then in cash flow statement, I only need changes in working capital, so I'll delete this part. And I need investments in my fixed assets, fixed capital investments basically. So I'll delete this part. Fixed assets purchase, I have to consider. Fixed assets sold, I have to consider. Investments, interest, dividends, invest in subsidiaries, loans to subsidiaries, share acquisition cancelled, and other investing items. I don't have to consider these things, so I'll delete it. Okay. So I'll come to this cash from financing activities in a while. So this is the data that I need. So let me sort it properly. I'll delete this part. I'll bring this data and this data on top here. Okay. So these are the things that I'll be needing. Let me delete unwanted lines. Okay. Still, we have not considered this part, cash flow from financing activities. Okay. So we'll go here. We'll get my years here. So I'll simply copy this and we'll paste it here. I have years here. Then operating profit. So you need to tell me whether this is EBIT or EBITDA, that is EBIT or EBITDA. So see, depreciation is deducted after this. So this is profit before deducting interest, tax, and depreciation. So this is EBITDA. So let's get our EBITDAs here. I'll simply press equals to and we'll link it here. This is my EBITDA. Copy, paste. Okay. Less depreciation and amortization, figures are readily available. This one, enter, copy, paste. From EBITDA, if I subtract depreciation and amortization, I'll have EBIT. So this minus this, copy, paste. And since we are making our final calculation, let's continue with formatting at the same time. Okay, this is my EBIT less taxes. So I don't want the actual amount of tax paid. I just want to know the rate of tax at which the firm have paid. And from that, I'll be calculating what if I would have not taken any debt, then what would be the taxes that I would have paid. So I'll simply say this EBIT, if this is my entire profit, if there was no debt, there won't be any interest. So EBIT would be equals to profit before tax. Profit before tax multiplied by tax rate will give me taxes on the profit. So this is EBIT multiplied by this tax rate. Enter, copy, paste. Okay, this is the taxes on operating profit. If I subtract from operating profit the tax paid, I'll arrive at operating profits after tax. Okay, so let's format it. Let's draw top border here. Alt H BP. Then Alt H K, Alt H 9, Alt H 9. Okay, this is my net operating profits. From these profits, I'll be investing in my working capital. I'll be investing in my fixed assets. So I can source my working capital from here, from this cash flow, working capital investments, working capital changes. So this is negative 316. Simply, right? Investments in fixed assets could be sourced from cash flow statement, investing activities. I'll say equals to fixed assets purchased. This will take away cash from me, plus fixed assets sold. So net fixed assets purchased, net amount invested in fixed assets. Enter, copy, paste. Okay. And depreciation and amortization is simply available here. I'll paste, copy, paste. Okay. Now my free cash flows I can calculate. Free cash flows would be NOPAT minus investments in fixed assets, since it already contains minus sign, I need to add it, plus minus changes in working capital, plus depreciation and amortization. I'll copy it and I paste it. So these are the free cash flows in the last 10 years, right? This is FCFF. But instead of calculating free cash flows to the entire firm, suppose you want to calculate free cash flow to equity shareholders, FCFE. Then in that case, from whatever your free cash flows are, that is cash flow available after making investments in the business, you will say less amount paid to debt holders. So you have paid principal and you have paid interest, and this information could be sourced from here, cash flow from financing activities. So proceeds from shares, this is cash flow related to equity shareholders. Proceeds from borrowings, this is loan taken basically. Proceeds repayment of borrowings, this is loan repaid. Interest paid, this is also paid to equity shareholders. The interest paid is also paid to debt shareholders. Dividend paid is paid to equity shareholders. I don't need it. Then financial liabilities, I'm not very sure about this. Still, since this is known as considered as financial liabilities, I'll consider them as a part of loan. And other financing item, we still have to go into their annual reports and have to see details about it. But for ease of calculation, let us consider this as a part of loans. Okay, so this is the net amount that I have paid towards my debt holders. Okay, so let's go back here and let's calculate amount paid to debt holders. This would be sum of This is the amount that I have paid towards my financial liabilities. This is the amount that I have borrowed from them. This is the amount that I have repaid them. And this other financing liabilities is also that I have repaid them. Okay. I'll close it. I have intentionally not considered this interest wala part. I'll tell you why. I'll simply copy and paste it. This is my amount paid to debt holders. This is basically the principal repayments, but still interest payment have to be considered. So I'll say whatever this is plus interest paid, but this should be after tax. This should be after tax. So multiplied by 1 minus, because whenever you pay interest to someone, your expenses goes down. If your expenses goes down, your tax liability, your tax outflow also goes down. So when you pay something to someone, your net cash expenditure decreases. Therefore, you save on your tax expenditure. Therefore, you have to consider this. Now, 1 minus, you would be intrigued to take this 17% as a tax rate. But ideally, you should consider the marginal tax rate here. That is the maximum tax rate. During 2009 wala period, it was around 33%. I've just hard punched here, 33%. I'll copy it from here till here. Okay. So this is the amount paid to debt holders, including interest and principal. Okay. Then this is free cash flow to equity, FCFE. So it would be FCFF minus this. Copy, paste. So this is the final answer that we were looking for, FCFE, free cash flow to equity shareholders. Okay, so this is how you calculate free cash flow to firm and free cash flow to equity. I hope this video added value to your time. If in case you have any queries or questions, feel free to reach us at thewallstreetschool.com or in the comment section below. Thank you.